ran 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 chala utu sare ran re
dan 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 dan
The caste system is unique to India. It's a unique social system existing only in India. When I say of India, I mean also the Indian subcontinent. Because caste in some form exists in Bangladesh, Pakistan, Nepal, and Sri Lanka. So this is a unique contribution of India to human civilization. In all societies, we have hierarchies and stratification. Generally, it is a class-stratified society. And within that, there are other social divisions of stratification. But the peculiarity of India's social system is that it is molded and shaped by a centuries-old division of labor. It started as a division of labor and then got fixed and rigidified as a hierarchical system. Obviously, it is based on your birth, where you are born. It is also maintained by what sociologists say, exogamy. Exogamy means you cannot marry outside your social group. That is strictly observed. And this social system or social order has been sanctified by religion. So this is the nature of the social system which is called caste. Since it is only applicable to India, people from outside have had to try to understand it from their own society's experience, etc. But everybody recognizes that this is something which is not found in any other society. The tribal societies, the societies based on other social divisions. But caste is unique to India. There can be a lot of discussion, and there's been a lot of research on the origins of the caste system, caste has evolved in India over the centuries, whether it is 2000 years, 2500 years old, where in the ancient Vedic literature there is the mention of the various, some of the castes, etc. That need not detain us here. What we have to take up or consider is what is the Marxist understanding of caste and the caste system. That is what we must be first clear about. And it is on that basis that we work out our approach and our strategy for tackling the issue of caste in our society. So I will be mainly concentrating on a Marxist understanding and approach to caste and the caste system. Why is it necessary to have a Marxist understanding or approach to caste? It is necessary because we are talking about in our programmatic understanding, in our strategy, we talk about making the People's Democratic Revolution. And in that People's Democratic Revolution, the classes we want to mobilize, whether it's the working class, whether it's the peasantry, whether it's the agricultural workers, different sections of the working people, they are not living and working in our society purely in terms of only class. They also have, apart from their class character or origins, they also have a caste identity. Unless we take that into account also, we will not be able to adopt correct strategy and tactics. That is, there can be, take the category of agricultural workers, whom we call the rural proletariat. Now, by and large, agricultural workers are belonging to the Dalits, caste, or most backward caste, by and large. So, what is their living and social and economic conditions? If you don't take the whole thing in totality, you will not be able to work and mobilize the agricultural workers to become part of the basic foundation or the basic alliance in the People's Democratic Front. So that is why it's necessary for us to have a scientific understanding about caste system and caste. So, in discussing the caste question in India, we have to also look at our past record and experience. There was an understanding or a trend in the Marxist analysis of caste that caste is part of the superstructure of society. You are aware in Marxism there is this base and superstructure theory. Base is the material foundations, the product and force of production of material foundations. And based on that mode of production, you have the, based on this material base of production, you have the various superstructural features. That is, under feudalism, you will have a type of political setup, you will have a type of legal setup, you will have a type of state structure, judicial setup, cultural relations, etc. And under capitalism, that changes. The superstructure also changes. When the capitalist productive forces develop and capitalist becomes the dominant mode, then all the superstructural changes take place. So there is a base and there is a superstructure. And both interact with each other. Sometimes changes in the base will lead to the initiation of changes in the superstructure, and sometimes changes or movement in the superstructure can also act as a catalyst for changes in the base. Now, generally, Marxists have tended to think that it's only by transforming the base, the material basis of production, only then we can really change the superstructure. So, a serious trend in Indian Marxist understanding of caste was that caste is part of the superstructure. It is used to buttress the existing mode of production or the production relations. So while we fight against the caste oppression and abolition of work for the abolition of caste system, it's only when we really change the material basis of the production can caste also be abolished, or caste will disappear from society. This was an inbuilt understanding in much of the analysis of caste in India from the Marxist standpoint. The understanding was by and large that caste and caste relations are part of the old society, which was the feudal society or the pre-capitalist society. So we are working for the democratic revolution, which will abolish all these pre-capitalist relations, abolish the feudal vestiges, semi-feudal relations. And in that process, we will go towards socialism also. But the completion of the democratic revolution will help us to abolish all these old feudal and pre-capitalist relations, which includes caste also. So let us concentrate on that. Agrarian revolution means abolishing landlordism, radical land reforms, and once that is done, the social setup also in the village will go change. It will help us to eliminate it. So this has led to a certain what is called deterministic attitude. If this happens, it will happen. So we don't have to. Subjective involvement or intervention to actively play an anti-caste role, to develop an anti-caste movement, to create an anti-caste consciousness among the people. All this gets delayed or postponed. Let us first finish the basic task, which is the socio-economic conditions in the rural areas. If they are changed, then caste will also abolish itself. This has proved to be a defective and insufficient understanding about the nature of the democratic revolution and also the nature of the caste system. So the idea that caste is a pre-capitalist relation or a feudal relation, which was popularly there in our own understanding, in our own agitation and propaganda, we would say that all this feudal remnants must be removed. That is not correct, because caste is very much a social relation which has adapted, or capitalism has co-opted the caste system as capitalism develops. So caste exists in a feudal society, and caste is now existing in a bourgeois society. Therefore, it is important to understand what is the role of the caste. Little discussion I've had with many of our Marxist scholars. I say caste is not just part of the superstructure. Caste is part of the base also. Without that, you cannot have a proper understanding of the caste. Why do I say caste has also got, is part of the relations of production in our society? Here, I would like to quote from one of the foremost Marxist scholars India has produced, which is D.D. Kosambi, who has written also extensively on ancient India, on caste and society there, etc. So what he said, I think, captures the essence of the caste system. So of course, there have been further changes after capitalist development. So Kosambi had said, and I quote, "Caste is class at the primitive level of production, a religious method of forming social consciousness in such a manner that the primary producer is deprived of his surplus with the minimum coercion, unquote. There is, to put it in a most simplified way, caste is actually originally a form of class. At the lowest level, and it had religious sanction, so that in the consciousness of the people, it was that this is the way I am born and I live. This is the I am in this. I have to accept this order, social order. This is the ordained, divine order by God, by religion, etc. This helped those who had to take the surplus, appropriate the surplus from the actual producer, to do it without too much force and coercion, because they made the person who is exploited believe that this is the way society is ordained. I belong to this order of society. What I produce or what I labor to produce, it's not my wealth or it's not my income. So it has the class aspect, it has the social hierarchy aspect, it has the religious aspect. All this knit together evolved the caste system. And if this was the case, he's talking about ancient India, that caste system got developed and elaborated, adapting according to the different social conditions in India in different regions. As capitalism has developed and become the dominant mode of production in India, caste is very much present in the relations of production. And there comes the key issue which differentiates Marxists from others who look at the caste system, which is that for us caste and class is intertwined or interlinked. And what was said earlier, that caste is concealed class, that is one way Marxists put it. It's caste, the inner part of caste is a class content. But that is not static, it has changed as capitalism develops. There is a correlation, there was a correlation between caste and class. But as capitalism developed, there is differentiation also developing within the caste. So caste and class are intertwined in the sense sometimes caste and class overlap, sometimes caste and class dichotomy or divisions take place. So with so many decades of capitalist development today, that class-caste correlation has not remained static. There are some lower castes among which one section has developed into capitalists or agrarian capitalists or urban capitalists. There are sections of the upper caste who have gone down to the level of the proletariat and become working class. You have all sorts of changes. But at the same time, the hierarchical nature of caste, the social, what you might call regressive character, reactionary character of caste in terms of hierarchy, that remains also. So we have to recognize that our struggle or our fight must take into account both these aspects, which is, unlike those who say, not Marxists who say, we fight caste. They say we are against caste. But they cannot abolish or fight caste because they are not seeing the interlinkage between caste and class. Unless we develop a class struggle which incorporates the social aspect of anti-caste, of fight against caste oppression, we cannot bring about the basic social transformation we are aiming for, which is end of class exploitation and end of social oppression or caste oppression. This is the area in which we must concentrate. So we have to see the capitalism that exists in India as a capitalism with specific Indian characteristics. If we just put generally capitalism, we miss something essential for our strategy and tactics. And that is that when capitalism developed after independence, it started with a compromise by the bourgeoisie with landlordism and servitude relations. One. Two, there was no thoroughgoing agrarian democratic transformation. Three, caste hierarchies have continued, or caste structure has continued as part of the developing bourgeois system or capitalist system. All these three features have to be kept in mind. The way the capitalist class has been formed in India, and the way the working class has been formed in India, or the urban and rural proletariat, if you study that, you will see their caste roots also. I'm not going into it in detail, but the dominant bourgeois or capitalist class in India comes from some specific castes. Generally, what in our Chaturvarna system is the Vaishyas, the Baniyas, the traders and moneylenders. Who are the big capitalists in India? Who are the Bidlas? Who are the Ambanis? Who are the Adanis? Who are the Singhaniyas? All of them come from this caste. In fact, after independence, except for Tatas, who was Parsi origin, all came from this moneylending, Baniya trader caste. Even in South India, that role was played by Chettiyars here initially. Of course, they were diversified now. But if you don't understand the caste aspect of our class formation, this bourgeoisie is prone to the appeal of Hindutva also because of their caste background. Today, when Hindutva has become a dominant this thing, there is a natural affinity. So, if you don't understand this, we won't work out correct strategy and tactics. Same thing with the working class. You go to vast areas where mining, construction workers, all, we have 8.5 crores Adivasis and tribal people in India. How many of them have been driven into the ranks of this most exploited section of workers? You'll find the bonded type labor, unorganized type labor, most of them origin will be Adivasi and scheduled caste. So the class formation also, all the class origin or roots, caste origin and roots must be studied.